Well, welcome everyone to today's webinar from the Open Group. Thank you for joining us today. This is our second webinar in a series of webinars that will lead us up to the end of 2013. Today's webinar is being brought to us by an Open Group member, Enterprise Architects, and today's speaker is Craig Martin from the said company.
Thank you, Simon, and thank you to the Open Group for hosting this webinar. As a lead up to the Open Group conference in London, which is around business transformation, finance, government, and healthcare. So we're just doing a few webinars and tweet jams and that leading up to that conference. And just to mention that, yes, we normally make these presentations available on SlideShare. So what you, everything you see today, you should be able to download from the SlideShare as well as the recorded version that Simon referred to. So just a quick introduction. Some of you may not be familiar with EA. So we're a specialist company within the space, headquartered out of Melbourne. And we have offices in the UK and a managed office out of the US as well. But we focus very much on the capability uplift, in other words, the training and the resources and people side, as well as the delivery of architectural outcomes piece of work as well. So that's really the space that we have. We deal with Tier 1 and Tier 2 clients around the globe and lots of war stories that we can share. So for those of you who want to get in touch with us, there's the Twitter handle as well as my email address. And then also just leading up to some of the events, which are basically leading up to the Open Group conference, which is in London. So for those of you that are in London in October, those are the dates for the conference. We'll also be running a two-day business architecture course on the back of that, so for the Thursday and the Friday. So if you do attend, you do have the option to get a, you know, a heavily discounted price to attend that particular course on the back of the Open Group, which is all about discovering business architecture. And then the week after, we have a sort of a full four-day course, which is all of the practical aspects as well as the theoretical aspects rolled into the 4 days. There's also a tweet jam coming up that's fairly exciting topic that we've been spending a lot of time researching, which is around business disruption, and I'm going to allude to some of those aspects during this particular presentation. And that will be followed up on the 10th of October by a similar webinar such as this. So if you want to have some discussion with us, there's all the details. You'll be able to download all of this when you get the link to the presentation in SlideShare. Now, as is my habit, I have a lot of content that I like to share. Some of you might feel that it's a bit of overkill and I do run a bit fast. You can download the recording, watch it at your leisure, as well as the presentation. But let me move straight into it. And for those of you that have been tracking some of our previous webinars, I always land up starting with this little framework, which is really about sort of centering us back on the purpose of business. And we're in the stage where more and more of business is becoming what we refer to as utility, what's being industrialized. And the true differentiation comes in with how we innovate, assemble, and mix that utility layer. And what we're seeking to do is to design business models that can effectively address those challenges. So really, every business is primarily about building advantages, prolonging advantages, and reducing the disadvantages. And what makes you an effective businessman or an effective architect is how well you're able to innovate and assemble the mix of that utility layer that sits beneath. And really, that's the key challenge for us as business architects, is that where across the spectrum do we get involved? Are we involved in the utility layer? And I'll elaborate on that a little further later. Or are we involved up at sort of a higher mandate area in which we're able to effectively generate and create business models to facilitate a greater disruption in the marketplace? Now, some of you may have seen this picture, and really it deals with what's referred to as a knowledge funnel, and a lot of our thinking within the EA space deals with how we can understand this space, which is this mystery space, and identify the right heuristics to be able to take advantage of that utility layer that I keep referring to at the bottom. And really, this space in the middle, this heuristic space, which are the rules of thumb, that space is the business architecture world. And the architects that are the most successful are those that are able to understand what those rules of thumb are and how to apply them within the business space. But obviously they need aspects of the utility parts of the business for those heuristics to work effectively. So there's a sort of a journey that you need to travel as you're sort of moving up the curve of your business architecture discipline in understanding sort of lower level, sort of algorithmic, smaller consumable bits of your organization, and then becoming more and more mature in how you execute business and how you mix those building blocks together effectively up to the heuristic layer. And here you can see it sort of all merged into one slide, in which we basically say, well, we're taking the mystery, which is that intuitive thinking space, where all the innovation occurs, all the right brain stuff occurs up top there. And as architects, we're trying to understand that mystery space better. And that mystery space is often the sort of cloudy area. It doesn't apply to a mechanistic metaphor like we're used to. We talk about building blocks within the architecture space. But up in that mystery space, it's more organic, and it's sort of like a cloud. It's always moving around and amorphous. And the architect's job is to try and take that mystery space effectively and work it down using a variety of tools that I'm going to introduce you to today. Now, one of the sort of challenges that we're seeing, or sort of one of the shifts that we're seeing, is that this concept of chunking, in that the business architect function and even your business sponsors, they're being asked to solve bigger problems. So, you know, nowadays, this word business model disruption and blue ocean strategy, it's almost becoming a common word now. And how do we disrupt an entire business model? So in the past, you know, a lot of the architecture discipline was involved in maybe componentizing the business, sitting within the automation space, doing a CBM type model, component-based modeling, all of those types of things. And then it kind of moved up a level, and it's sort of in the capability space. Okay, how can we now, there's a slightly more coarse-grained view of the business, and it's in the capability world, how can we assemble the right capabilities to solve the business problem? And it's kind of moving right up. Some of the expectations now are, okay, how do you create an entire disruptive business model? So no longer do you just have to solve just the smaller, fine-grained bits of the organization. Organizations are also looking to be able to build these agile business models to disrupt the industry in a far more efficient manner. So our challenge as business architects is actually to move right across that spectrum and sort of deal with all of this chunking information that we've got to process. And really, that's the space that we tend to find our challenges. And this is specifically from one of the industries in which we encounter this problem, which is the financial services industry, in which there's often an ownership which sits up at the top strategic landscape. There's often an ownership which sits down at the bottom, sitting under the CIO. But there's this lack of ownership which sits in the middle here, which is really the understanding of the business and the understanding of the tools and techniques to be able to mix the business to solve certain outcomes. And then on the right-hand side there's often a misunderstanding of or even a lack of role clarity around whose responsibility actually is it to understand the heuristics right across those capability spectrums. And I'll introduce some more detail on capability later. And you'll understand what a functional versus a cross-functional capability means later as well. But this is really this capability space. In other words, people, process, and tools to drive out an outcome. Well, what is that? Who's responsible for those capabilities and improving them? How can I string those capabilities together in different ways to drive out different outcomes within my business? And ownership of that space is often fairly hazy within organizations. So there is this journey that the industry is currently undertaking. And what I'm going to introduce you to today is kind of like the landscape which business architecture is being used for business improvement, not necessarily market improvement, but that's part of the journey that we're traveling as we go. And this is kind of that speaks to that as well, and this is really talks around this concept of strategic importance versus the complexity. And the business architect's world is everything that you see on the right-hand side there, and probably more so moving up into that sort of top right quadrant, which is all around ways to design the business to be more effective. And you can see we've overlaid some of the more traditional roles from the business analyst to some of the more Six Sigma practitioners that focus on certain areas of this quadrant graph. And what you've got in the bottom right quadrant are all of your skills which look at improvement and efficiencies and getting rid of waste and all of those aspects, versus at the top there, which is a lot of that space is the mystery space and identifying those heuristics in order to try and make those, find the heuristics and algorithmatize, if that's such a word, those heuristics as effectively as possible so that I can look for efficiencies using some of those techniques like Six Sigma and Lean. And that's the process of moving stuff from the top right quadrant down to the bottom right quadrant as effectively as possible. And that's your role as a business architect, which is what you have to strive for. Now, just to give you a view of the business architecture mandate quickly, and really there is some confusion around where the business architect sits. Is this just another role? We view it within EA as one of the domains, and you'll see that within the TOGA framework. It's one of the domains that sits within a lot of the architectural frameworks, and you can see the overlap coming here, in which there is an overlap between the business technology information landscapes, and there's lots of debate around whether information is considered a business architecture discipline. I'm one of those that believes it is quite strongly. But that's the sort of space, those are the overlaps that we're dealing with. And this concept of business capabilities often comes into play in that sort of area, that overlap in the middle there, in which it brings together the tools bit, brings together the information, it brings together the process bit to drive out particular outcomes. And that's what you're striving to do as a business architect within the industry. Now, the challenge that you have in that space is that you often don't have the mandate to be able to operate at some of these senior levels. So recall I introduced you to this concept of chunking. In other words, at the lower mandate level, we introduce processes, we take those processes and we componentize them. Perhaps we put them into some kind of procedural language. Perhaps we put them into some technology to automate them. But as we are required to solve bigger and more complex problems, we kind of move up there, and now we're in the capability space and looking at ways that we can orchestrate capabilities more effectively across an enterprise, eventually right up into that sort of top chunk space, which is, well, it has an entire business model. You know, how do we do mergers and acquisitions? How do we innovate this business model and take away fundamental pillars of that business model? So, for example, in the insurance industry, take away customers paying for premiums. Now, innovate your business model without customers having to pay you premiums. How can you make money? And those are the types of disruptive patterns that need to occur. But business architecture often doesn't have that mandate. And it's kind of sitting here at the C level there, not the C-suite level, but in this particular mandate curve at, say, C, which really talks about improving business performance as opposed to the market performance bits that sit at the top. However, more often than not, the business architect function is still relegated to that area at the bottom, which is the A and B area, which is very project specific. And how you can see it in line with some research coming from the Executive Council. And what this is saying is that ultimately a lot of business is trying to understand how to use the architectural discipline to increase flexibility and speed. That's the language which is coming from a lot of the sort of more mature adopters of the business architecture discipline. So it's almost an aspirational piece. But truth be told, most business architecture exercises are probably sitting a little one below that, which is reducing costs. So in other words, how can my business architecture discipline help me reduce operating costs across the business? And that's where the majority of business architecture projects that we execute on as well tend to focus their effort. And a lot of that has to do with things like improving my investment slate, improving my project investment, my CapEx expenditure across my project landscape. Am I investing in the right areas? Is there an overlap between the 280 programs that are currently running in my enterprise? You know, am I getting the value for money across those programs? Are there any overlaps? And can I reduce costs by looking at those through an architectural lens? And that tends to be more of a driver for the business architecture landscape. And that's really what I want to focus some effort on just for our remainder of the time, is sort of these areas here. And this is what we deal with in our Discovering Business Architecture course. We have a Discovering Business Architecture and a Mastering Business Architecture. And the Discovering one deals with this layer in the middle here, and there's this gap which sits at the operating model space, as well as this area which is referred to as functional capabilities. And in order for us to focus on that area, we introduce you to this very high-level framework. We drill down into a little further detail. But really, no rocket science here. When I'm building a business architecture, well, what aspects of that business architecture do I need to consider? Well, there's the organizational aspects of it, which is the what of business architecture, and that's the content. And, you've all heard of the meta models. Otogas has their own meta model. We use things like the business motivation model. We customize it to be able to deal with specific business and strategic motivational aspects. There's the executing business architecture, which is a how space. By the way, let me just close off that business architecture content, which is the what space at the bottom. And that's really around how do I categorize my bits of architectural content effectively. So what's a capability? Is there a standard definition? What's it made up of? Is it made up of people, process, and tools to drive out an outcome? What is a process? How does it relate to a function? How does it relate to data? So all of those concepts that we often wrestle with in our understanding of an architectural landscape, that's what, you know, is what we refer to as this content model for business architecture, and that's the motivation model we use. Above that is the how space, and I introduce you to a method now. And then ultimately, you're going to present all of that in a series of views to answer certain outcomes. So this is referred to as an outcome-based architecture, as opposed to just doing architecture for the sake of architecture. And I'll introduce you to some value streaming to show you how that works. And then you've got a couple of architectural practice bits that you need to have in place when you're actually building your architectural organization. The capability model, the services catalog, how you change your business and engagement model. I haven't drilled down too far in those in this particular session. Here you can see a view of the architectural method. This one is our customized one specifically for our course. And you can kind of see all of the types of outputs that we take you through the duration of introducing you to the business architecture landscape. And I'm going to show you a couple of those models as we progress. But really kind of moving from the goals and objectives phase, being able to articulate that into the business motivation model, being able to prototype various business models using things like the business model canvas, and then being able to look at your value system and your value chain that you drive out, and then being able to produce your capabilities from that, and ultimately all your overlays that you can put on top of those capabilities to answer certain strategic concerns within your organization. And that's really the sort of method that we find works quite effective in this, let's call it this utility layer of architecture, in other words, this business improvement space. And it's not the super chunk of creating disruptive business models, but more that sort of middle layer, which is around creating the right mixes of capability to answer certain strategic questions. And really what we do is we take you through this macro to micro view, going from the motivational layer right down. And we find this quite effective with clients, and it's quite simple as we kind of take them through this process. And really what we do is a series of models that we produce out of this exercise. And sitting at the top is what we refer to as a business motivation model, which is actually kind of named after the meta model that we use. And that's a view which represents the strategic intent of the organization and how we can drive that strategic intent out through particular tactics. So we look at drivers, we look at levers, we look at the tactics and objectives layer, and get an understanding of, you know, what levers can we pull in the organization to be able to achieve the outcomes that they're looking for. And then that goes down to the business model canvas space, in which we're able to prototype various ways that we can execute against that motivation and pretty much have conversations with our strategic intent, so to speak, and I'll elaborate a little further on all of these a bit later. That goes down into your value system model, looking at the business at an overall level, the entire value system, the value chain, culminating in the capability model, and ultimately down into all the resources that sit within the capability model to operationalize it. So let me just elaborate, start with the motivation model and introduce you to some of those concepts that sit at the top. So this is sort of a very high-level view of business motivation based upon the OMG business motivation model. So as an architect, this is one of the key documents that you need to download, and you can download it from the OMG. It's fairly easy to understand. It's quite comprehensive, and talks around these concepts of what's referred to as a means to an end. So what you have on the left is the means, and what you have on the right is the end. And all the components on the left are the means for me to achieve all of the aspects on the right, and they're also decomposable. So my strategies are made up of tactics, my goals are made up of objectives. And what you find is that up at the strategic layer, there's still a lot of fragmentation around this place. So the architecture discipline is around to try and reduce that fragmentation. But in actual fact, up at this level is actually where it begins, because there are multiple strategic and planning disciplines that sit in an organization, and they all have a completely different language of how they define strategic intent. And that's what's good about the OMG model, is it gives you a common reference model for you to be able to understand what is strategic intent and how to sort of categorize and pigeonhole a number of these concepts and what each of them mean. So take the time to go and research that model. And what we do is we roll all of those pieces into, this is just an overview of one of our templates. This is a, call it a canvas if you want, of a business motivation model. And we look at the customers, the channels, we roll the mission and vision, driver strategies and levers, and we decompose the goals and objectives into an artifact which we give to business. And this particular artifact is only valid for business people. In other words, it's when you, as a business architect, it's when you're wearing your business hat. And it looks like this, right, as an example. And, you know, as an architect, a lot of architects look at this and they're like, well, yeah, that's great, but, you know, it's quite simple. You know, I need some more detail to be able to bridge the gap between strategy and intent. And that's understandable. This particular artifact you're using for your discussions with your business planners, your subject matter experts, your strategic planning teams, those particular individuals. And those individuals, for them, this particular artifact is gold. They love it. They love being able to see all of their intent on one page, and they can use it as their own anchor model. And that's what we actually use it for. We actually use it as an anchor model, and you can actually begin to overlay a variety of other views on top of this particular anchor model to begin to have a conversation with your strategic planners. In other words, how far, for example, you see here, how far is your current project investment landscape in contributing to some of those objectives? You can overlay financial data on here. You can overlay even maturity and some gaps across your organization. You can have a conversation that is outcome-focused as opposed to, for example, capability-focused, because often individuals at this level don't really understand the concept of capability, so they're kind of like grappling with it, and, you know, it still requires a little bit of a journey for them to travel. But this stuff they understand, this they get. Now, all of this talks about here is that, you know, once again, this is your business hat that you're applying. So you can use the business motivation model to have conversations with your architects, right? But ultimately they're looking for something else. They're looking for something in a little more detail. So you as a business architect, you have to take this motivation. So you have to understand it. You have to source it. So you either design it or you source it. Now, most of the business architect responsibility is to source this information and drop it into this particular kind of structure and represent it back to business, show them that you have an understanding and strategic intent. Your next job is to now take that further down and start to show the architectural landscape and represent that intent in the form of a business model. So let's move this a little further down and look at the strategy and business layer. And let's understand how we can perform strategic scenarios using something like the business model canvas, and how we can, for example, use a value system model as well. So all of these are pieces that we take you through as we teach you business architecture. So you're getting a light touch of some of these components of the journey that we take you through. Have a whole bunch of case studies that we work with as you travel that path with us. So what is a business model? Well, ultimately, the business model is this unifying concept which shows individuals what the business looks like. And when you hear things like business model innovation, business model disruption, that's really having a discussion around, well, what's possible, right? And you're prototyping your thinking to see what is actually possible with the business that we currently have. And then that's realized, or you're, depending upon your sequence, some people do business model innovation before they do strategy. Some people do strategy before they do the business model innovation. So depending on your style, you'll have one before the other. And that's normally talking about what will we do. And ultimately, that's realized in a business architecture, which really takes a look at all of these components, looks at the strategic intent, looks at what's possible, and goes through an exercise of determining, okay, how realistic are those aspects of the business? How realistic is that particular innovative business model, and what could it look like if we were to mix the business underneath in a particular fashion? And that's where you start to produce your blueprint space. Now, just staying up in that sort of business model innovation area, what you have is this concept called disruption, and I don't want to spend too much time here, but we spend quite a lot of time talking about disruption. What does it mean? You know, so for example, according to Alex Osterwalder, there's various ways that you can measure disruption within a business model. And some of them are looking at things like switching costs, recurring revenues, you know, and then game-changing cost structures. And these are the sort of the more famous organizations that have used some of those aspects to create innovative business models. So for example, Nespresso managed to get us to the point by charging us 8 times more for a cup of coffee than what we were originally paying for it, by releasing this model of capsules. Apple managed to introduce this high switching cost barriers for us. So Apple, funny enough, doesn't make all its money from iTunes and content. That's not where it makes its money. It makes its money from its infrastructure, from its hardware. But to prevent you from switching, they introduce all those other services. So, you know, the switching costs for you are quite high. Facebook is what's called a shifting the burden business model, and basically they create money, they generate money from other people creating the content, from you creating the content in Facebook. So they shift the burden to you and they make money from your efforts. So there's a variety of business model disruption, and that's really about sort of revolutionizing the industry with technology that has caught up, and then looking at the old way we do things and disrupting that old way in which we used to execute. And that's what I mean by business model disruption. And ultimately, that's the level that you want to get at. You want to be able to take this business model, which is a big chunk piece of data. So when I'm talking about this top chunk, and you're going to look at that entire business model and say, okay, well, how valid is that business model? And you want to be able to measure its maturity, measure its outcome. And what I've included here is, you know, a fairly nice little model from Rita Gunther-McGrath around how you can measure the effectiveness of a business model. And what you want to be able to do is you want to be able to take that strategic intent and you want to be able to play it out across a variety of different types of game-changing business models and then measure them against the standard structure, reporting back to business around, well, this is what the business model could look like. And that's where you'll use aspects like the canvas. Now, a very light touch we introduce in discovering business architecture. I mean, the canvas is a whole journey in itself how to use. And all we introduce you to is just certain aspects of using left-right brain, what you do across the infrastructure, offer customers in financial viability space. But predominantly for you to prototype and play with your ideas around trying to achieve some of that strategic intent. And really the way that works is the shift between left and right brain. And you can see I've introduced this career path here. So this, I don't go into detail on the canvas. There's lots of material available for you to read through. You can also acquire the book and there's a couple of YouTube videos that you can watch to give you an introduction into the canvas. But what your career path is as a business architect is to move kind of from that left infrastructure space further up the space. To the right, more closer and closer to the customer, and you'll start to experience more of your interaction with those customer experience journeys, customer value maps, and those types of aspects. But in order to shift your thinking from just the developing and optimizing the capability on the back end, let's see, I'm still online. All good. You've got to be able to operate at the right mandate. And you can see I've referred to the mandate in the previous part of this conversation. And that means that to disrupt business models, you have to position your business architecture function at this level. In other words, it's got to sit at this enterprise planning space. And there's not many organizations that sit at this space that use business architecture up at this level. It's kind of still, it's the cutting edge of the business architecture discipline. And that sort of cutting edge really allows you to, you know, drill down at a strategic level and start to play with a number of strategic scenarios. What you've got here is that sort of top-level mandate, which is improving my market performance. And you can see that there's a variety of strategic scenarios that this particular client might want to play out. And what you want to do is you want to prototype each of those scenarios to see, well, how effective are they going to be in the market and how easy will it be for me to actually implement some of those models. And that's the business architecture function, is to understand the detail and how to assemble and mix each of those different scenarios. And that's where we find the canvas is a useful tool. Instead of going down into all the detail, you'll use that canvas layer. But as I said, that's sort of the cutting edge. That's the top part of the pyramid. The majority of organizations well, not the majority of organizations, let's just say that the current shift within the business architecture scape is to try and move business architecture at least above the PMO office, the program portfolio and project management space. So in other words, to be able to design the business at an holistic level first before you start initiating a whole bunch of deliverables. And what that looks like is really taking my means to an end space. And instead of building an initiative landscape, first look at my capabilities required to achieve those strategic themes through the lens of a unified business model. And that's the area that we focus on. And those are some of the additional artifacts that I'm going to show you through in our remaining time around how do we do this particular part? How do we improve business performance by creating this unified business model, and what type of outcome can we actually achieve from that exercise? And just to finish that story off, this is the traditional landscape of the business architecture discipline. In other words, it sits under the project and portfolio space within a project, often under the CIO, under the technical landscape, and a lot of research has been done that those positioning the business architecture practice there is not an effective use of this discipline. So it's not an IT tool. It's got to be positioned outside of that and preferably above that PMO landscape. And that really speaks, this diagram speaks to that, where really you go through the motivational aspects of your business, you produce your strategic themes, and you do a strategy map, and from that you produce a variety of initiatives. Those are farmed out to various strategic business units. Each of them goes ahead and starts building their own business model, their own styles and flavors. And if I had you all in front of me, I'd ask you for a show of hands to say, well, how many business models do you have in your organization? And most organizations, especially tier one organizations we walk into, they'll have three or four different models within the organization, each developed by different vendors. So they'll have target operating models. They'll have capability models, anchor models, a variety of different ways to represent the business. And it just creates some confusion. They don't have a unified lens to be able to look through. So let's continue our journey. So now we've looked at some of the strategic landscape and motivational landscape that sits at the top. We've looked at different ways that we can take those motivational pieces and be able to play with some of those ideas within a canvas. And as I say, this is a very light touch of what we would normally take you through in one of these exercises. Now what we want to do is we want to just expand that a little further into this space called the value system space. So you need to understand the concept of, well, what does a value system look like? And this means looking at the bigger picture of your organization in light of the entire system that it works with. So, for example, in the safe society value system, you could be working with any one of these particular organizations, whether it's the penal system, whether it's the enforcement system, which is the police or government, whatever the case might be, but they all have a very, very strong relationship to one another. And as a business architect and trying to understand the organization and its context to build a value chain, it's often extremely valuable for you to step out of just the core firm value chain and be able to look at that organization in the context of all of the other pieces of the puzzle across this value system space. Now, we don't see too many value systems out there, and I really think that it's a big piece of the puzzle that's missing. Porter's first introduced around, well, you know, it's even systems thinking view is always look at your organization within the context, within the environment and the soil that you're operating in. So it's important that you understand this value system space. And that'll allow you to take, sort of example, value chains and look at all of your competitors and break it down across, you know, a variety of sub-value chains to be able to understand, you know, which organizations fit where and where they operate, more or less to it. So this is a slightly dated view of modeling organizations against sort of a core value chain of producing content. But this is sort of a value system view. It's not a complex exercise, but it does understand a lot of your sort of inputs and outputs, and especially if you're in logistics and supply chain and those types of things. There's a lot of complexity and a lot of work that's been done in some of those places, for example, through the Supply Chain Council. And what we tend to do is we tend to represent that detail into this business model template. So there's just a little view. It's almost a canvas to represent a slightly more detail. You could turn that on its side, and it could be a slightly more detailed view of the business model canvas. What I've done here is I've just introduced our own canvas that we run as EA, just so that everybody is clear and understands what this business does, who its key buyers are, what industries it operates in, what are the channels that it works with. These are all the pieces that you need within your organization just to get that understanding. And what you're doing is you're taking that strategic intent and you're moving further and further down. You're understanding more about it and you're creating more and more understanding as you move through the organization. So you'll sit with a motivation model in one hand. You'll have the canvas that you've selected in the next hand. Your next step is to have a model such as this, which now expands it into a little more detail. And now we take you down into the next step, which is the sort of the firm value chain space. And this is where you really now you're focusing not on the entire system, but you're focusing specifically on your organization and the value that you provide across your particular value chain. That's the concept of a value chain, is that you must be able to measure value across that chain. So you perform aligning to performance models, KPAs and KPIs is quite important, and I'll show you a view of what an outcome of something like that could look like. But what you want to do here is you want to be able to take aspects of your business model canvas, which you see on the bottom left here, and you can use pieces from your key resources and your key activities, and you can use those to drive out, sort of identify your key activities and your primary activities that run across your value chain, as well as all of the underlying resources that need to move through that value chain. So you can see how these two worlds now start to fit together, and we give you some idea on how to do that as we take you through that exercise. And that will give you an idea of, you know, the logistics example of, you know, there's one of the value chains that run across. Well, what value do I add across that entire value chain? What's my measure? What are my KPIs as I move through that site? Well, you must be able to represent that value and show it back to business, or else it's just, you know, it's a bunch of names and a chevron. And you want to be able to show it. But the only reason it's called a value chain is that you're actually showing the value and the milestones that you're achieving on the value, on that particular value chain. So now what you want to do, you've looked at the value system. You've looked at your core value chain, you've understood some of the more detailed bits. Now you want to begin to understand capability. All right, now what capabilities do I need to be able to facilitate the journey across that value chain, to be able to facilitate those types of business model prototypes that I might have been able to work with, probably would have selected one based upon the mandate that the business would have been operating at. And you want to produce what we refer to as an anchor model, in our case, a capability anchor model. And that's really where this particular piece talks to, is around what now in the functional space, which really talks about, well, what does the business do? And we refer to these as functional capabilities. These are the building blocks of the organization. And the way that we define it is in line with a number of the standards in which, you know, you look at a capability and you're referring to people, process, and tools to drive out a particular outcome. And that's how we see capability. We add information in there depending upon the maturity of the organization and what they're willing to be able to absorb. But, you know, there are far more complex models that you can look at to define a capability, and you see those specifically in the defense space. But here, you know, very, very simple way to view it, people, process, and tools to drive an outcome. And that's what results in what's referred to as outcome-based architecture. You have to understand the outcome that your capabilities are achieving, else, you know, there's just a bunch, once again, a bunch of boxes and they've got names in the middle of them. So you want to go to link them to your motivation model, and we tend to do that to the objectives layer because you've got SMART objectives, which are specific, measurable, actionable, realistic, and time-based. So there's good performance metrics in there so you can show the value tangibly to the business of what each capability delivers. And what you do is you roll that up into your anchor model. So this is an example of a value chain, right? And underneath that are some capabilities in an argument notation. And the way you've got to view an anchor model is it's like a map of a city. And you can overlay a variety of things onto the map. So there's the Sydney map. I can overlay onto that population. I can overlay the power grid. I can overlay the sewage grid. I can overlay, you know, tourist areas across that value group. That's the point of this model, is it becomes an anchor within your organization, and you can start to address a number of challenges in your organization once you have this single consolidated model, this lens that you can view your entire enterprise in. And you can kind of see here a variety of ways that you can overlay different views on exactly the same image. Well, this is what you're actually doing within the anchor model space. And what we've learned along the way is that there's a variety of ways that you can represent capability. Just on this model, for those of you that are familiar with the BizBlock side, they're adding a whole lot of new dimension to the business architecture space. And once again, it's also a nice bit of ammunition that you can use as you're traveling on this journey of a business architect. A lot of what we use is in line with that way of thinking around the concept of a capability and all of the different pieces that you can use that capability for around initiative planning, cost and performance analysis, and all the rest of it. So these are some of the views sourced from the BizBlock, which will help you, give you a set of tools to be able to use your capabilities more effectively. So it's one of the key takeouts here, is that often business doesn't understand this concept of a capability. And I think I've mentioned this before in other webinars, it's good to talk to them in light and concept of people, process, and tools, because business understands this. And you can see we've overlaid that in line with motivational aspects that sit on the right-hand side. So those are the types of motivational pieces that we'd want to be able to address. And you can see how people, process, and tools would affect each of those motivational aspects. And it's important to remember that business people, once again, that's the audience that you want to be able to focus most of your time on. So the people, process, and tools language and the outcome-based language, that's the language that they want to talk about. But ultimately, the architects need that level of detail, slightly more level detail, and they rely upon the anchor model. And you can see here is a variety of overlays that you can now put over this anchor model, and you can answer a variety of questions. Right? So let's have a look at a couple of those. So here you can see we've used the TOGAF way of describing a viewpoint. And this particular overlay looks at strategic alignments. What it says is, okay, well, where are the highest strategically valuable items? And you can see their anchor model on the right-hand side. And just through color coding, you can immediately see, well, where strategic value lies. And the nice way of representing and putting the viewpoint description on these diagrams is you can immediately have a look at the set of concerns that you're dealing with, and you can build what's referred to as a viewpoint library. So as we teach you about business architecture, we teach you how to produce one of these. We teach you how to produce one of these overlays, which is how do you understand business capability maturity, and how do you represent that maturity on the same anchor model, and what does it mean to go from a low level of maturity to a more managed, optimized level of maturity? How big is that leap, and what change is required in the organization to address that? So here is another overlay that you can put over your anchor model, followed by this one, which looks at your project investment. So this is a current CapEx investment space. So all the projects, what's going on across that project space? Where am I investing most of my effort within the organization? Where is that investment skewed across the entire enterprise model? And is there a reason for that skewing? Can we link it effectively up to the strategic landscape? What happens if I look at my strategic value with my project investment? Are they actually aligned? And if not, why aren't they aligned? So there's another one of the views that you can produce as an overlay, which sits across the traditional anchor model. This one looks at hotspots and issues, which are very tactically driven. And this one's going to look at just the caution, be careful not to become too hotspots and issue focused, but then you do tend to produce a tactically driven architecture. But it's always good to understand, well, in my investment slate and my strategic value, am I actually dealing with some of the issues which are quite political? Can I sort of kill two birds with one stone as I address some of those challenges? And the area where we find the most value is when you start to put views side by side, and you're able to then draw inferences from that and tell a story from that. So, don't squeeze too much information on these graphs. Keep them separate, dealing with different concerns. And then as you put them out in front of your stakeholders, they can look at it, and there's actually a story that is telling them. They can ask some questions. Well, why are we investing so much here? And why aren't these strategically valuable? And that's the point you want to get to, is you want to put all of those overlays in front of them. Now, just very quickly, and I see I'm running out a bit of time here, is those anchor models, they have a short lifespan, right? And once you've been able to produce this series of overlays, they answer a variety of key questions. But ultimately, the business people, they want to know outcome-based information. They want to know, okay, I've got this big box of how we do stuff. How can I mix that box effectively to drive out the outcomes that I'm looking for in the business? And that's where this cross-functional space does. So what it does is it's far more outcome-focused. Is it looks at a way to take all of those building blocks and, using our framework in the beginning, mix and assemble them in different ways to drive out different outcomes. And now this is the true architecting space. Sure, at the functional capability landscape, you're looking at the underlying resources and you're looking at how to mix that. You're looking at how to mix people, process, and tools effectively. And that also has value for the business people. But the true value sort of up at the enterprise level is sort of how can we mix those components, sorry, those capabilities across an entire enterprise to drive out some of the top-level goals within the organization. So this is an example of how you can represent that. You can kind of see here, if we've just highlighted the process dimension of a cross-functional capability, but you can then see the people, process, and tool capability, the building blocks that it uses and consumes across that cycle. Now you can match that to project space, and you can see, well, which projects are actually currently working across those capability building blocks, and now can I focus my attention on those particular projects so that I can enable a cross-functional capability more effectively. So this is, for example, if documented in the ArchiMate notation, which is a standard way of documenting architectural artifacts. It's one of the courses that we provide as well. And then you can take that information, you're using the bucket at the top there, you're stringing it together in a variety of different ways, and you're representing it for the business to drive out different outcomes. And that's really all I wanted to talk about within the cross-functional landscape. It's a slightly more advanced skill set, not something that you do if you're on a low level of maturity within the architectural landscape. So focus on the what and the functional and the anchor model space first, and then there is... As your maturity increases, you can then move into the space here, which is a slightly more advanced space and recommended for a later cycle. Now, BizBoc refers to these as value streams. You may have heard the term before. Sort of a confusion which might exist around the lean thinking and value stream mapping space. I suppose it's a tool which you can use to do the same thing, but when you refer to cross-functional capabilities, we're referring to the same concept of the value streams of business that BizBoc refers to. So there's ways that you can string stuff together in different ways to achieve different outcomes. That's all we're driving at here. And ultimately, once you've got all this information, you're going to want to look at how you transition. So you've got all these overlays, you've looked at current state, future state, maturity, well, how do I actually put all this data together and produce a series of views which can tell the stakeholder a story on how to change their business. In other words, transform their organization. Because even the Open Group conference coming up, it's all about transformation. And a lot of the conferences we go and present at, that's one of the big topics on everyone's mind is this transformation. And even if you're trying to build disruptive business models, it ultimately boils down to transformation. I can have all these models and all these overlays, that's all fine. But unless you have a roadmap on the table that shows you how to transform your business, you know, you're not going to get your architecture, you're not going to get the kind of buy-in you're looking for. So you want to be able to focus on this transition space. And I've done a fairly basic view of how you could look at your strategic importance and your maturity landscape. And you can start to look at the types of changes required across a BAU, incremental significant transformational change, around the degree of change that must occur across your capability. So the red there is current maturity. The amber on an example I put there on the left there is in-flight projects are getting you to that level of maturity. And there's an incremental change required to get me to the target maturity that I'm looking for, which is the green. We take you through an exercise of, you know, building an insurance company and, you know, basically plotting all your capabilities across this landscape to show how we can disrupt the insurance landscape just as a case study. Now, all of this kind of rolls up into this model. This is a sort of core template or matrix that I would suggest you use. Lots of value that can come out of this. We score maturity based upon a standard maturity model. We score strategic value based upon the number of levers that it intersects with or the number of objectives that each capability intersects with, and we weight that and we score it. You can also score based upon your organic target state and the projects and where those projects are getting you. In other words, what focus areas are those projects working on? You can look at the hotspots across your organization. You can then look at the gap that exists between the two, and you can look at the business impact to be able to plug that gap, looking at significant incremental and transformational bridging. And you can then start to plot the gap analysis across people, process, and tools. And one of the things that we focus on is sort of teaching you some of the interesting techniques around identifying gaps and building transformational exercises and understanding how to, you know, create sequence just by looking at information across your organization. And at a high level, you can roll it into outputs that look like this. You can see there's cross-functional capabilities on the left. Well, in order to enable those core cross-functional capabilities, there are all the strategic scenarios that sit across the top. I would have played those out using the business model canvas. And if I wanted to, I might have drilled down to a level of detail which looked at incremental significant transformational change required, and this kind of gives a view of, well, you know, these are the types of results we're looking for to enable some of those strategic scenarios that sit at the top. And all of this information is good for an architect, but you've got to eventually take this and basically represent it in a view for your stakeholders. And I'll finish off by just showing you one or two of those. So we want to be able to take this raw data and represent it, and one of the techniques we do is we build these capability shapes. And you can see a couple here. We've got our super shape which sits on the right-hand side there, which is everything you ever need to know about a capability rolled into one shape. and basically we can benchmark that against different industries and see how they've been assembled across different industries, all that stuff. Way too much information for a lot of business stakeholders. Cool stuff for an architect, you know, there's lots of raw data there. You apply a good BI tool on top of that, like Tableau, which is quite easy. You can dice and splice that information in fantastic ways and produce some really, really good graphs which come out and answer some critical questions across your enterprise. But you'd kind of like more want to go to the left there. You know, even that's probably a little complicated. Maybe the one in the middle is probably a little more docile, looking at the outcome of what you want to achieve across people, process, and tools and some of the core processes that you do. But you want to be able to build these shapes so that you can represent certain concerns across your organization. And you want to be able to tell the story. Well, here's the entire architectural story. And this particular one, depending upon the maturity of an organization, it's got fantastic levels of detail on it. But this organization was able to process that level of detail. And you can see here, well, that's my current OPEX and CAPEX, what's occurring across my entire project portfolio, what's the maturity uplift, and what changes are occurring across that project portfolio. Lots of information rolled into this anchor model to be able to tell an architectural story to your stakeholders. And just finishing off, this is our template on how we produce the ultimate roadmaps. You can roll all this information into a very nice A3-based roadmap, which looks at taking your vision, mission, and goals and strategies on the left there, looking at your decomposed objectives, your drivers, assumptions, and principles, and being able to map your program of work against those, specifically looking at your current state on the left and your target state on the right, risks, time, cost, and effort. You can actually fit all of this information in one roadmap view, and that's what it looks like at that level. Right, and these are the types of artifacts that your stakeholders are going to walk around with, you know, and this is showing them how they're going to transform their business. It's showing them the investment required across which programs are contributing to what parts of their business motivation, how much it's costing you, what is the risk attributed to those projects, and what's the end outcome I'm going to get, you know, and the value I'm going to achieve from that. Incredibly powerful artifacts to tell a story from the project level right up to your business motivation models. And these are the types of pieces of information that people walk around with a lot and have conversations around an enterprise. And ultimately, what you want your architect to do, and this is a key piece which I want to leave with you in my final slide, is you've got to be able to tell a story. Right. And that bottom picture, for example, is the architectural story inside Prezi. And so it becomes an artifact that stakeholders can actually interact with within Prezi, and they can drill down into. So instead of carrying a thick A3 pack, load it in Prezi, and they can watch it on their iPad and, you know, be able to have conversations around it and drill into the low-level detail by zooming in. Nice tool for you to be able to do that. But ultimately, these are the types of walkthroughs that we do quite often. So you put all these artifacts on the wall and you tell a story. But ideally, you want to get to the point where you actually don't have to use words to do that. You want to be able to get your stakeholders to understand their business and draw the conclusions from the architecture and the business architecture that you've put on the wall to have a better understanding of their business and come to those conclusions themselves. And that's sort of a tick in our box for a job well done. A lot of these artifacts, if we have to spend a significant amount of time talking through it, we probably miss the boat a little. But ultimately, it becomes a fine art around creating the right view to be able to represent those types of outcomes. Right, so I ran through a lot of content in 55 minutes, and I know you're probably feeling your head spinning a little, but play the recording back, download the presentation on SlideShare. I've given you all of the channels that you can interact with us, specifically on some of the Twitter space and our blog space. Happy to interact with you and mentor you and give you some guidance on how to sort of mature your business architecture practice and take you along this journey. Right, over to you, Simon.
Oh, that's great, Craig, and many, many thanks for your time. Keeping an eye on the chat, I think it's very clear that you've got people thinking here, Craig. There's been some very interesting discussions going on in chat. And we do have some questions, so let's spend just a few minutes going through some of the questions on QA. Got a first question here from Praveen asking, how do you stitch architecture to processes, and which tools would you use to identify the variances? He also asks about suggestion cost savings. How would you respond to that, Craig?
So I think at this business architectural landscape, obviously looking at people, process, and tools, what you're addressing there is the process component or what you're looking at. Now, normally at this initial stage of business architecture, we find that the journey here at this level is, when I spoke about that chunking example, is up at the capability level, looking at the project portfolio and those types of aspects. To drill down a little further, once we've looked across the strategic landscape of architecture, so you know, you've kind of had a view of some of the artifacts, it causes us to focus our attention on certain areas, like, oh, why is that area over there got so much investment? Why is that area over there got a high OPEX and there's no projects that are currently allocated to it? And that causes us to ask some natural questions. We can take the capability landscape and plot it across strategic value and complexity, and depending upon where those capabilities sit, it tells us sort of what areas we must focus at. So, for example, up at this business level, let's take a high OPEX spend with a low CAPEX investment. That's a classic case to tell me that there is an efficiency opportunity in which I can apply some tools like Lean Six Sigma theory of constraints to that particular area to begin to optimize the processes in the detail of that area. So the architectural landscape has shown me the entire enterprise, and I've been able to plot it across an entire enterprise landscape. But what it now also allows me to do is focus on certain areas that, you know, kind of look a little out of place, and now I can drill down into that process landscape, and now I can particularly apply some of those tools and methods and techniques to be able to address the process shortfall within those spaces to look at, for example, efficiencies. Hopefully that makes sense.
That's great, Craig. Thank you. Just responding to a few people on chat. Yes, this presentation and the whole event will be available on a recording from tomorrow. Everyone that's registered for today's event will get an email, and that email will contain a link to where you can access that recording. So yes, a full recording is available from tomorrow. The next two questions, Craig, I'm going to stitch together, one from Hayan and one from Wojciech. Hayan asks, to whom should business architects ideally report? And a follow-on question, have you any hints on methods for increasing business architects' mandate?
That's an interesting one, and I do get that question a lot. The standard off-the-cuff answer, an architect must always respond with, it depends. We've spoken about the mandate curve, so it depends upon the mandate. But to be effective at this level, you should not be reporting to the CIO. You should not be reporting to the CTO. You should be hopefully reporting to the Office of Strategic Management. Sometimes people put it under the COO because the discipline could sit within the operational aspects of the business, at least be managed in that space, and they can provide services up to the core value chain. I still find that's a little problematic, although it's a better route to follow to position it under the COO. I would prefer that the practice actually sits horizontally across the core value chain and reports to the Office of Strategic Management. And often that is into the CEO landscape, into what's referred to as integrated business planning landscape. So you will have organizations, especially tier one organizations, that have this concept of enterprise planning and IBP. And in there is a specific head of integrated business planning and the strategic planning portfolio, and that's the particular individual that I think is the best one to be able to sponsor this discipline across the landscape. However, if you can get it to sit with under the COO, that's your first milestone that you want to be able to achieve. Now, to deal with the second question, to improve the mandate, besides reading The Art of War, I think that there's some interesting political maneuverings that you can do, and there's sort of organizational structural changes. So you can focus on certain high-value items within a project structure. I've seen they were quite effective around creating a temporary team, in inverted commas, reporting to a business individual from the core value chain with a specific outcome to deliver a result, and pulling in certain subject matter experts along the way and producing value quite effectively and quite quickly. But all under the guise of it's a project landscape. Now we're just under a project, but we've got a senior sponsor to go with. And ultimately, if you're able to produce that value quite effectively and quite quickly, people start asking for those services more, and you've inadvertently, you know, your plan was to make it a full-time function as opposed to a project-based function. And I've seen that work quite effectively, and that it goes within that project space, and eventually produce the value quite quickly and becomes a full-time project, a full-time function within the organization. So it's kind of occurred covertly without treading on too many toes. But there's a couple of org models that apply, and I could probably even flick some to some people if they ask me for them.
Thank you, Craig. And if Stacey Smith is still online, hopefully that's answered your questions well. You put up a similar question there, so hopefully Craig's covered off that for you as well. Just looking at the time, got to keep an eye on the time because we are running a little over. A couple more, though. We've got a question here from Israel asking, you draw a straight line between BA and SA. What does happen with information system architect and technology architect?
Yeah, that I see those as domains of an enterprise architect. So you will have an enterprise architect, and there are a variety of domains that they would operate with. So the business architect, I presume you're referring to, let me just get the diagram up so that we can, hopefully you're still sharing the screen. Perhaps it's that diagram, or an evolution of it. So the information architect, I see it as a domain and a discipline that cuts across that. So as I mentioned previously, I believe that the information discipline sits within business architecture. I think that's the place that it adds the most value, but it's often one of the most weakest areas within an organization. So I often find that a business architect with a strong alliance with an information discipline or information architect in that space, you could start right up at that level. And even from a business planning perspective, I can show you how to design an enterprise roadmap right across an organization just by using information principles and showing you dependencies and all of those pieces. So it's the information space provides a significant amount of value up at that level. The technology space, those are sort of disciplines that would sit normally below the project and portfolio landscape, normally within the solution architecture, solution development space. They'd be cross-cutting within that particular area, but I see them as domains within the enterprise space.
Okay, Craig, well, looking at the time, I think that we're going to make the next question the last one. So if there are any outstanding questions that we won't get round to today, please don't hesitate to take those on offline with us. I can always help as and in between I can make sure questions get through to Craig. So the last question today then, Craig, this is from Jonathan. If you start making objectives smart, then do you not also run the danger of the focus turning towards achieving the metrics rather than focus on organizational value? There's a good one to end on.
Yeah, that's actually a very good question. And yes, you know, you do run the risk of doing that. What you've got to do is you've actually got to build what we refer to as the driver tree hierarchy. So you actually build a hierarchy of objectives. And you can then cascade those down to the lower level. So you've got to make sure that you know, if you're familiar with the concept of partitioning, that there is a strategic partitioning model, a segment partitioning model, and a capability model. So you'll find that your SMART objectives will also cascade according to that partitioning structure. So you'll have strategic SMART objectives, you can then have segment, and you can have capability. So my advice to you is that you can actually decompose that. And you'll see that as you decompose those objectives, they actually get closer and closer to capability language. They get closer and closer to verb noun language. So the transition from those low-level pieces to defining capabilities required to achieve them actually becomes a whole lot simpler. Often, especially at the strategic layer, you've got these broad strategic objectives, and they may be smartly defined, but you know, at the end of the day, you're scratching your head trying to figure out how you're going to link those to some capabilities underneath. So, a very, very good question. Yes, you would need to decompose your objectives to a suitable enough level to allow you to be able to identify the capabilities from those.
All right, Craig. Well, that's fantastic. Well, thank you everyone for joining us today, and Craig, many, many thanks for your time. I do believe that EA is running another webinar with the Open Group. I think it's on the 10th of October. Is that correct, Craig?
Yep, I think that's it.
Please do keep an eye out on the Open Group webinar schedule page for that. And once again, I'd like to thank everyone. And at this stage, I'm going to bring the event to a halt.
Yes, thank you, everyone. And a lot of information, and happy to answer questions offline as well. So thank you for joining me. I appreciate the time.